Hello everyone, my name is Adrian Błonka and hope you are doing well. In this episode, we will focus on creating the foundation, and this episode will be the last one where we define the geometry for our structure. I also decided to model two types of foundation, the direct one and indirect one. So, this episode will be divided into two sub-episodes. The first one will focus on defining the direct foundation, which corresponding with defining the spring elements connected via kinematic constraints with our foot. And the next one, the indirect foundation, will be defined by steel piles around the foot, which will also be connected via kinematic constraints with the foot. And also to do this, we will have to define the stiffness of our soil, defining the soil profile in bore in program Aqua in Sofistic, and then we will have to calculate the stiffness of the soil using program Hasse in Sofistic. So the second part will be a little bit more complicated than the first one, so we will start with the direct foundation. But before that, I would like to ask you for subscribing and smashing the like button. I really appreciate that. It helps me to develop this channel and motivated me to make further videos. So, without any further elongation, let's get started. Before we will start modeling our sheet piles around the foot, I will show you the solution I made for one of my first model with this type of structure. You can say that it could be one of the first model with this type of structure, because the meshing of the foot is really messy. That's why I want to have a full control of the meshing, just to avoid such singularities, as you can see there. Okay, but the idea is the same. We will have to model the sheet piles as beam elements. But the connection between the beam elements and the foot will be solved in our example in different way, by using the kinematic constraints just to match the meshing of the foot with the location of the starting point from of the sheet piles. Okay, the second thing we have to remember, that we have to model not a single U cross section, which I made here, but we have to make double sheet sections. W, sorry, sheet sections. Why? I will explain that right here. Imagine that we have to determine the resistance of the soil, and we have to compare the normal force which will occur in the sheet piles, and compare it with the resistance of the soil we calculated manually or using some other program or software. So imagine that if we have W cross section, then if we have 200 kilonewtons of compression force and 50 kilonewton of bending moment in this direction and in this direction, then if you make combination which will minimize and maximize the normal forces, then we will get in both situations 200 kilonewtons of compression force, and this is the correct answer for 2U sheet piles. But if we make them as a separate beams, then the program will transform this bending moment into pair of forces, and as a result, we will get 100 kilonewtons of compression force from the 200 kilonewtons of compression total force for 2U cross sections, and the additional 100 kilonewtons of forces which are made from the as a pair force, which is representing the bending moment. So the compression force in one of the U cross section will be 200, and in the second one will be zero. In the second example, in the second load case, the situation will be opposite, and the force, normal force in the first U section will be 0, and in the second one 200. And if you make the combination, then you will get that the maximum compression force, or the minimum force in both cross sections, in both beams, will be 200, but so in total 400 kilonewtons. But if you look at the maximum, so the tensile normal force, you will get 0 in both beams, which could be misinterpreted by the designer. So just to avoid this problem, I suggest to make W cross section, which I learned it by the practice. Okay, so firstly we have to know what is the length of each edge of the foot. Next we will have to get to know what is the length of the full amplitude of this cross section, so the width of the W cross section. We will then divide the length of, for example, this edge by the length of this cross section, the width of this cross section, and then we will get the total number of cross section that have to be created in this edge, on this edge. And then we will make some offset from there, because for example we can get some irrational or rational result, and we need the natural result, so countable number of sheet piles. We are not able to model 1.5 sheet pile in this example, so we will have to offset them and center them to the edge, and then we will make them along the edge, and some distance in the side we will remain, which is not important in this example, and losing one U cross section of the sheet pile is not a big deal, not a big loss to resistance of the foundation. Okay, so now we have to find those two points, and we will start with the longer edge of the foot. So let's move on and find those points. Okay, so we need this point from this sub area, so it should be somewhere here. Okay, go to set, and I guess we have to take the last element. Yes, we have to. Okay, next we have to find this point, so let's move on to, I guess, this sub area. Okay, I guessed correctly, and we need this point. Okay, fantastic, go further. Now let's use the component distance and measure the distance between those two points, 70 meters and 24 centimeters. Okay, now we have to determine the shape of this cross section. To do this, I will use the catalog of ArcelorMittal W cross section, in the example U cross section. I suggest to use GU 18400, I usually use it, or GU 16400 as a sheet piles under the foot as a indirect foundation. Okay, so to determine the geometry of this cross section, we need the total width we have, 800 millimeters, the width of the imaginary flanges, so 252 millimeters, the total height of the cross section, so 290 92 mm, and the thickness of the flanges, imaginary flanges, and the imaginary webs. The flanges have thickness of 50 mm, and webs have thickness of 9 and 7 millimeters, 7/10 of millimeter. Okay, so let's just remember this one and insert those dimensions into Grasshopper. So the first, so let's define it from one millimeter, but with precision of 1/10 of the millimeter to 1 meter, I guess should be enough. So it will be total width of the cross section, and it should be 80 centimeters. Flange width in meters, in this example it's 252 millimeters. Flange thickness is 15 millimeters, and web thickness it's 9 millimeters and 7/10 of the millimeter. Okay, let's order them, and now we are able to determine the cross section. Before to do this, we will look at the Sophistic code and check how to do this. Let's start with defining new section. I will move this manual to the right. If you want to have this manual, you just have to press the F1 key on the keyboard. Okay, we will name it with number no variable, with material number of I guess 20, but we will also make it as a variable. We don't have any material of reinforcements because we are making steel cross section, and everything else is not needed to define. Now we have to define the walls of this W cross section, and to do this we will use the command for thin walled structures. So type pane number, it will be number 1. YB is the coordinate of the start point of the thin wall, and also ZB is a Z component of the start point. And also you have to define the endpoint of this first panel, and then repeat the process. So in this example it will be, because we are operating in local cross sections coordinate system, so we have to refer to this point as its center point in our example. I will mark it more clearly. So this is our first reference point, so point 0, 0, and any other point will be referred to this point as a point 0, 0. Okay, so the base point in this example. Okay, so let's name that the total width will be just large B, and the width of the flanges will be BF. The thickness of the flanges will be TF, and the thickness of the webs will be TW. Okay, so first coordinate is minus B, BB. Okay, so double BB, just big B, because if we just type B, then we having also the variable BF as a width of the flange, and we will then subtract the only B, then f will remain and code will be messy. I'll show you that in next step. So minus bb and zb will be in this example 0. Next one is this one, and now we have to calculate the width of this segment. So we have already determined this point. Now we have to determine this point, and to do this we have to calculate this distance. This distance is a half of difference between this dimension and between this dimension, so bf. So we have to type b minus bf divided by 2, and it will be this dimension. Okay, so minus the double b plus the equation I have just said. So minus, sorry, the double b bf divided by 2. Okay, and zb will be equal to minus half the h divided by 2. Okay, and the thickness of this one is the thickness of the web, so tw. Okay, and now we manage to determine this part of the cross section. Now we have this point, and for the next part we have to only define this point. Okay, so going further, number 2, just copy this one. Oh, sorry, I also forgot to change this variable ze not zb. Okay, so just copy it, because the start point of the next panel is the ending point of the previous panel. Next we have to just use this one and add another bf. Okay, and ze is equal also this with the same value. Okay, now it's more clearly defined, and this one is the thickness of the flange. Okay, next one, just copy this one, zb, and now 0, because it is this point. So we have this one, and now we are making this one. So the ending point is the base point, so 0, 0 point. And the thickness of this one is the thickness of the web. Okay, everything is apply in millimeters. So we will have to keep it in mind and change the units. Sorry, 2 meters, because we want to apply the meters in our case. Or maybe we will multiply them by 1000. Yes, we can do this in Grasshopper, just to not mess this code. Okay, next one is this one, so 0 zb 0, and the ending point will be The same. So the ending point will be the same as this point, but we have to change the sign of y and z component of the coordinate. Coordinates. So let's just move there, copy it and make it negative. The same in this case. So ZE, and it's also the thickness of the web. Okay, pane 5. So not this one, but this one, and negate it. ZB will be also this one. YB, wait, sorry, we have to move it from there to there and copy this one. Okay, because I copy the point that should be the ending point of this pane, but I make it the beginning point. Made it the beginning point. Okay. TF, so the fingers of the flange, and the last one will be just WBB, and ZE is 0. Thickness is the thickness of the web. Okay, now we can copy it, but before that I will explain why we have to use the WBB name of this variable, because if you just name it by single B, then if you replace this string in Grasshopper, then you will also replace this part of variable BF, and only F will remain, which will cause error in Sophistic. So that's why you have to avoid making simple variables. They have to be longer and not be made from only one letter of number. Okay, now we are able to copy this one and implement it into Grasshopper. Let's stretch it out. Okay, and we see that we have to make double hashtag no variable, double hashtag m and no variable, double hashtag double b, double hashtag bf, h, tw and tf. Okay. Let's stretch it out and make those variables. So no variable, m and no while variable, double b, bf, h, tw and tf. Okay, group them and replace them. Go to set, use component replace. Go, go, go. Okay, we finished. Now let's make some variables. So number from 1 to 100, it will be number 5. Number of material, we can check it out. What is the number of steel in our example? It should be 20. Yes, it is. So 20 as a number of material. Also, to avoid the error that could occur when we make a cluster from those components, which we learned from the last episode, just use the data component, double data component to be more exact, before we will go further. Okay, now we have to apply the dimensions, but we have to remember that the default unit for pane in Teddy is defined in millimeters, so we have to convert the meters into millimeters. Just use a simple component in equation, x multiple by 1000, and do it for each variable. So BB is the total width. Total width, sorry, it's not total width, but the half of the total width. So we also we have, because as you can see, we make only BB, not the BB divided by 2. So BB is there, BF is correctly defined. H, we didn't define the height, so section height, it is how much? 292 millimeters. 292 millimeters. Okay, and we have to apply the full height, because I remember to divide it by 2, which I didn't when I was defining the total width of the cross section, but it's not a huge mistake. We fixed it by only one component. Okay, flange thickness is here and the web thickness is here. Let's organize it even better, just to be sure. Okay. Of course, we have to use this type of component to be even more sure that nothing will be broken when we will make a cluster. Okay. And we can also check the final result if everything is correctly replaced. As you can see, there is no variable with double hashtag, so I guess everything is okay. I don't also see any missing number after the variable in the sophistic. So let's make the final step before we will make the cluster. Okay, now we are ready. Okay, and let's find if everything is also okay. Yes, it is, because as you remember in the previous video, we make a cluster and the weight of the material was lost. Okay, so this one is the number of cross sections, so so number, this one is a material, number. This one is the total width in meters. This one is flange width. Okay. Flange thickness. Web thickness. And section thickness. And the result is text. If the result will be a program like Aqua, then I will name it as txt, not text, because then you I created a full program which can be implemented in the into Sophistic without replacing any text in already defined text. Okay. Let's move here and create another variable. So sect number 2 and just replace it. Sect number 2 and replace the text with this one. As you can see, the farther we go with our project, the more components we are creating, and in each project I'm trying to make new components and make my library of components even bigger, bigger, bigger. You can see that I have a drastic section where I created all of the components, and this category is growing with every project. I will show you those components further, and even maybe I will upload them into Food4 Rhino. Okay, but it will be a subject for another episode. Okay, now we made this cross section. We can check it out. Okay, fantastic. And also you can see that the dimensions are in millimeters, not in meters. We can check the result. Okay, without any errors and warnings. Let's check the report, and you can see that our cross section looks like the cross section from the catalog. Okay, fantastic. So we have thicker flanges than webs. Dimensions are in total not 800 millimeters, because Sophistic also takes into account this small part of the cross sections, which extend from the 800 millimeters. Also the total height is a little bit higher, because it takes into account the thickness of the flanges. Okay, so now we have the total width, and we can calculate how many W cross sections of the sheet pass have to be taken into account for this longer edge of the foot. So let's just use component for division and divide this length by the total width of the cross section. Now we will get some rational number or irrational number. In this example is 21 and a little more than the half, so we need to take only 21. To do this, just you go to math and subcategory utilities and use round component, or even better, I guess. Okay, round component is the best one, because you can check the floor value of the value and the ceiling value of this value. In this case we need to know the floor value, because we want this number to be decrease to not do to first smaller natural number. Okay, now we are able to calculate the remaining part. So just do this, and the remaining part should be a little more than the half, and it is. We can also calculate how much it is in millimeters. So multiply this one by the total width, because this is the part of the total width of one cross section. Now we know how much it is. It should be more than 400 millimeters, and it is. And we have to divide it by 2 to get to know how much we have to offset from the ending points of this edge. Because this is the total remaining distance, we have to divide by 2 to get the distance from the end, from the endings of the edge. Okay, so just divide it by 2, x divided by 2, okay, so this is not needed, this will be used later, and this one is not needed. Let's move them to the down, and now we have to create a line along this edge and define those points. We can use the vector, we can use another type of components, and we will in this example use another type of the components, because we have already used a vector method to define the geometry of the deck. Okay, so let's create a line, the line from those two points. Okay, and now we have to use, for example, evaluate curve. I will show you what this component can make from 0 to 2, for example, but we have to use rational numbers or irrational numbers. And as you can see, this component create a point along the curve, on in this example along this line, taking a part in one of the input you have to apply the relative or part of relative length of this edge. So if you apply half, you will get a point exactly in the middle of this edge. If you apply 0, you will get the start point of this line. And if you apply 1, you will get the last point. You are not able to apply more than 1 without making extrapolation, which can contain some mistakes. But in this example, we don't have to extrapolate. Okay, so if you want to have a fraction of the length, so relative length of the edge, we have to divide, we have to create a series of numbers which will represent the center of each beam, which will represent the center of the sheet piles, and then we will have to divide this series by the total length of this line. I will show you that, and I think it will be easy and understand it. Okay, so create a set, and the first input is the start point, the next one is the step of our series, and this last one is defining the number of values in the series. Okay, so the first point is offsetted from this start point of this line by the remaining distance in the endings, so this one, 21 centimeters, and the half of the W cross section, and then we will get the center point of the side on the first side cross section. So we have to take half of this value and add them. So starting point is obtained. The step is exactly the width of the W cross section, total width. And how many times? This one, 21 or 22. We will check it after making the points. I always want to check it. Let's check what we obtained. So this is our series. We can also flatten it to get rid of this series of unnecessary zeros. Okay, and now we have to divide them by the total length of this line. So this one, so this value, and now we should obtain the fraction of this length, and there should be symmetrical. So the sum of the first value and the last value should be equal to 1, and it is. So as you can see, we only have to use 21 without adding extra 1. Okay, and now we can apply it into this component. It's called evaluate curve component also, and it's really helpful because it also give us the information about the tangent, which is often used by me. Okay, so you can see we get the points of our sheet piles. I will also disable the points for the soil stiffness from the direct foundation. Okay, and now we have to move them to the bottom edge of the foot. So we have already done it here, and this vector is exactly the vector in z direction, but with negative side, with value of the half of the foot's thickness. So we can make it enable and move it down where our points are defined. Just add this vector to this points and connect them with the line. Okay, now we have to define the total length, or the length of the piles from the bottom edge of the foot to the ground, to the soil. Okay, so let's start with, I guess, 5 meters and finish with 12 meters. So piles length below foot in meters and set it to 7. We have to also now define the vector in z direction, but with the negative sign. So make it negative and add this vector to those points. Okay, now we will make a lines and divide them in z direction, just to create a single elements as we made previously defining the whole model, because we want to have the full control of the meshing of our structure. Okay, so let's create line between those points and divide this line between 5 and 20 elements. 5 is, I think, enough, maybe 7. Okay, that's definitely quite enough. Okay, and now we have to use our component. which could be found here, I guess. Yes, of course. Go down, go down, and check it out. Okay, and now create new lines. Okay, as you can see, they should be organized like that. So the first lines are here, the second lines are here, and so on, deeper and deeper into the soil. Okay, fantastic. Now let's implement them into Sophistic component line, structural line. Okay. Also, we want to have a control of the local coordinate system, because as you remember, we provide an opportunity to change the shape of the structure by adding an additional angle variable. So the z vector from the local coordinate system should be pointed in this direction, perpendicular to this edge where the beams or piles are defined. Okay, so how to do this? For example, we can make a vector from this point to this point and rotate it along global z coordinate vector by 90 degrees. So go to vector and rotate it along z axis by 90 or minus 90 degrees. Also remember to change the units from degrees to radians. Okay, and now we are able to do this, and you can see that the local z coordinate vector is pointed perpendicular to the edge where the piles are defined. So, as we want it to be. Fantastic. X vector is always pointed along the line, so you don't have to change it. Okay, we can also make a cluster from it, because we don't need to look at those all components every time. Okay, what else can we do? Hinges, sections. Section is defined here, and also we have a control of the number of this cross section. It's 5 in this example, so let's just implement it and apply the results. So go to the nearest defined Sophistic component and apply the results, and let's check it out. Moment of truth. Fantastic. I forgot to make those lines single elements. So let's come back here and apply the user tags we have already defined previously. Not a single quad, not a single quad, but as div. Where is it? Beams. Okay, flanges as div. Exactly. Go to the down and apply user tags. Okay, now let's calculate this, because as you saw, that the density of the mesh was too high. Now it's much better. Okay, so you can see that we managed to do this, to define the beams. Now we have to create the couplings between the points from the beams and the points from the foot. If you want to connect the beginning point of the sheet piles, we have to find the nearest point in the edge of the feet, of the foot, sorry. So before that we have to determine the points from this edge. We have already done it, but we only have to collect all of this data and sort them in correct order. So let's go farther, or even we don't have to sort them. We will check it out. We will find it out. Where is it? There is it, there and there. Okay. So without end, so I guess if I take only the last element and just use the component to division, I will get this one. Okay. So points are determined right here. Now we have to find points from this edge. So let's find them. There should be somewhere here. Points. Okay. So I guess we have to take the first or the last point, and use this one. Okay. So we managed to collect all of this data, and the remaining one, those points. I guess it should be somewhere here. Yes, to be 100% sure, just use this one. Yes, okay. Now we have to combine all of these points, and also we have to remember that the points between those two sub areas are duplicated. So for example, this point is duplicated because it belongs to this sub area and to this sub area. So let's collect all of this data as we did previously. Flatten the output. Now we have to get rid of the duplicated points. So go to vector and in subcategory points just find the cool duplicates and set a really small tolerance. I always use 1/1000th of meter, and we also can check if the number of elements was changed. So we had 24 points and now we should have 22, and we get okay, fantastic. Now let's find the nearest point from the beginning point, from the start point of each pile in this edge. So to do this, go to vector point and use the component closest point, not closest points, but only one, because we only need one point for each sheet pile. Okay, so closest point. So let's just try it. We have where they are there. So we have our points from the beams. So let's apply them to the P input and those points to the C input and check if the result is as we want it to be. And I think it is. So let's check it out. 0 to 5. Let's use those points and those points. And now, so as you can see, the closest point to this one is obviously this point. For this point, it should be this one. Let's check it out. Yes, it is. For this one is a really close point. Okay, it managed to find it. For this one, it should be this point. and so on and so on. You see that it's working. So now we are able to connect them. We can move it to the top and just create a coupling between points from the foot, foot's edge to be more accurate, and the start point from the pies, the top points from the pies, because the deformations of the foot is exactly the same as the formations of the pies, because pies are made in first place during the construction process. Okay, so this combination, as you can see, there could occur a situation where one point from the edge of the foot has two points for two different piles. If you want to avoid this situation, you can just make this meshing more dense, but it's not necessary to do this. Okay, and the fixation is a full fixation, so PPMM, full translation and full rotation. And now we are able to apply the results. Let's check the output from the Sophistic. Structural point refers to itself. The Sophistic has a problem because the distance between the start point from the pies is really close to the point from the edge of the foot. You can change it by decreasing the tolerance. I think we have already done it. Oh no, we didn't. So let's change the tolerance to a really small number. I suggest typing 100,000th. And now we will check the warnings should disappear. Oh, still one point has this problem, but previously we had 2 points, 3 points. If you don't want to decrease the intersection tolerance, let's just change the density of the division between beams, but it will also raise the time needed to calculate the program, so you have to make some balance between these two solutions. So you can see that we have only problem with this one, because there is no coupling. In this example, we were able to make the small coupling, so Sophistic didn't move this point to this one. And you can see that there is a point 1130, and it also should be a part of this beam element, so also this 1130 and also for this one. So the structure is correctly defined, but Sophistic made a small movement of this point just to match the node from the foot. Okay, I will get rid of this tolerance, because as you can see, it's not a problem. I just wanted to show you that sometimes if you don't want Sophistic to move those points, you can just fix this problem by decreasing the tolerance. Okay, so you can see that there are 1, 2, 3 points without three beams without kinematic constraints, so those three warnings should be correlated with those beams. And as you can see, there's also no problem with number of the node, which means that structure is working together. So now you have to repeat this process for each edge of the foot, and then repeat this process for another foot. I will not do it here because it will last too long. I will make short cinematic cut, and we will see again when I finish the work. Meanwhile, I managed to make a cluster from all of the stuff which were defined here, and this cluster allows us to define the lines of the piles and the points and connections really fast. And I copied it 4 times because there are 4 edges for each foot, and you can see the part of the result right here. And I will continue the work for the second foot. So we are back, and I organized the data. I also hide in the lines, and as you can see, we have the second group of the components, which represents the second foot, which you can see right here. So as you can see, the whole geometry is now done. Also, I checked the connections, they are working well. As you can see, there are some gaps in the corners because of this offset we have to make to fit to match our sheet piles along the edges. So always small gap will occur, but it doesn't remarkably affect the resistance of the indirect foundation. Okay, so now we have to define the stiffness of the half space of the soil. To define the half space, we have to go to Sophisic, and I will show you how to do this just in coding environment. So the first thing we have to do is to define our materials. Then we have to define the bore profile. So type bore, and you can see that there is a bore. Number of this bore will be 1, and we will only make a half space which will include the single bore profile. You can make more bore profiles or soil profiles and interpolate the stiffness and parameters of the soils between the bores. I will show you this option when we will define the half space, not only the bore profile. The bore profile should be defined in Aqua, but the half space will be determined, exactly the stiffness of the half space will be determined in the ASE program. So the ASE is a program which where you can make some calculations, and in ASE you can make calculations just for soils, for this half space. And one of these options you can make there is to define the stiffness of the half space, which will be then used in the stiffness matrix in your model. And then you will always have to remember just to apply the stiffness of the half space into your model when you calculate something further after that, because without that your geometry just levitates in the space. Okay, so bore. The next parameter we have to apply is the coordinate of the start point, and we will just type x value, and we will then switch this or replace this variable in Grasshopper, which will include the x, y and z coordinates. The next one is the direction of the soil profile. You can set it to default, and all of the remaining data also. Next one, we will use the B-lay, and this is corresponding with the layer of the soil strata. So the S is the ordinate along the profile axis, and the first should be set to 0. And now you have to type the number of the material. In this example it will be 100. But we will also make a second material just for making this example, but this material will be defined later. So I will substitute this one by material number 1, and all of other parameters will be calculated based on the parameters of this material. You can also change how the stiffness of this layer changes inside the soil, so in depth direction, as those graphics show. You can make just unit step stiffness, which we are doing now, but you can also change the derivative of this plot. Even then, you can change it to non-linear one, not only line one. Okay, so going back, the second one will be our second ordinate of the soil, and let's just set it that the second layer will start 5 meters below the bottom edge of the foot, and the second material number will be MNO2, and the last one and the last thing you have to do is just type the belay with S, which will be really huge, for example 30 huge hugely enough without typing another material, because and Sophistic will interpret this code that we have the first layer between 0 and 5 meters with parameters of material 1, the second layer starts at 5 meters below the bottom edge of the foot and ends 30 meters below the bottom edge of the foot, and then parameters of this layer are corresponding to the material number 2, and this is the end of your half space. Below that, the half space is rigid. Okay, so let's just copy it, and now we will define the second material and substitute the coordinates of the bore profile and substitute the numbers of the materials. We can also make the variable from the S coordinates, so it will be S1 and this will be S2 as the bottom part of each layer. Okay, just copy it and go to Grasshopper, create a panel and paste the code. Now we have to make some substitutions, so go to Aqua section and we will copy the component with the inputs to define new soil. Poisson ratio, foot 3, and so on and so on, and the output is this one. Okay, but in this example, this component just create a material with nonlinear parameters and bedding parameters, but for direct foundation we have to make another component which will make just the parameters of the soil, so it will be much simpler. I will show you that, so just copy it and disentangle this component from the previous one, because we want to keep this cluster and change something in this cluster, making new cluster. So this disentangle, I have a problem with pronouncing, but I hope it's not too bad. Okay, so we have to substitute the KZ by Young modulus, not by the stiffness of the half space we calculated manually. So just get rid of this one and also of this one, because we don't need the C parameter. So we can also get rid of the data input for this one. Okay, number will stay. KZ is our Euler Young modulus, sorry. Poisson ratio, wave, friction coefficient, and cohesion. So I think the so I think that's enough. Go back, and as you can see, our cluster became shorter, and we can see the output of this cluster. So as we expected it to be, in E, so in stiffness, there is the Young modulus, not the KZ, and everything else should be the same as for the output of the above cluster. We can check it out. So Poisson ratio is the same, weight type is more, Coulomb more soil, friction coefficient, cohesion, tensile strength, and the Dilatant angle are set to 0. Material reference crack is 0, and friction coefficient is equal to third of the friction angle, and the h is equal to 1 meter. The B mat is not necessary in this example, but we can but you can define this parameter, this bending parameter, and don't use it. Okay, so now we have to change the number of the soil to 101 and change the parameters. For example, 60, soil weight will be 19, friction angle 27, cohesion will remain because we want to have something like sand, but in this example it's weaker sand. Okay, so everything was changed and we can apply it. So let's go there. Soil material. So let's just merge those two outputs and join them. So go to set, merge component, and join component with flattening this one. And the separator, the joining separator, will be enter or even double enter. I'm trying to recognize the difference between double enter and double space bar in the panel. I change the shape of this panel, and if the shape is more vertical, then it means that it's double enter or single enter. And if I type one space bar or double space, I'm trying to make it more horizontal, just to recognize them what is going about, what is going on. Okay, and now we should get one element in this list with joint text, and it is. But as you can see, there is a Young modulus from this component, so let's just copy this one move this one to the left because we don't need it, and substitute this one, this soil with 100 number with the same parameters as before, and now apply. Now it's much better. Okay, and apply it here to soil material and check it out. Okay, so we have material 100 and 101 with the correct definition. Gamma is also defined. Okay, go back. Now we should define the bore profile. So use the replace component and substitute the X. So X will represent the coordinates. I will also explain one thing. If you in this example, if you apply those items in this order as they are described in this table in manual, then you don't have to type the item symbol. So if I type something like that, 0, 1, 2, then sophistically understand it that the x coordinate is equal to 1, then the next item in this list is y, so the y coordinate is equal to 1, and the next one is z, and z coordinate will be equal to 2. If I type further, then 10 will correspond with nx, 20 with ny, and 30 with nz, and so on and so on. So just a simple shortcut. That's why I don't type x, y, and z, because I only need x, and I know that the further items in this program or function should be y and z. Okay, the next one is s1, the second one is 2, and the further are MNO1 and MNO2. Okay, let's prepare the text replace component, and we will enter the replacing text further. Okay, so starting with x, we have to find the point on the level of the edge of the bottom edge of the foot. So let's go on to, I guess, somewhere here. Yes, where the foot thickness is defined. We need this vector. So let's just use the vector component and collect this data, add it to some point in foot, in the middle of the foot, in the middle of the foot. So for example, for those point, but before that, let's just take only one point from this set, from this one, never mind which one, and add it to, and add vector to this point. Okay, so we have the point on, why it's disappearing, I don't know why, now it's visible. Okay, so now this point should be at the level of the bottom edge of the foot, and we can deconstruct the coordinates of this point just to apply them into this input. So go to vector and deconstruct the point. Now we have to create a set by merging all of this data in correct order, flatten the list, and join the text with separator, one or two space, and check the result. Okay, so as we want it to be, apply this here. S1, let's just from this one to, I guess, 10 meters should be, 30 meters should be enough. Type 5 for S2, 30 for material number 1, so just use 100, sorry, 100 and 101. Okay, and check the result. Okay, fantastic. Now let's make some local variable in aqua file, ball definition. Ball definition. Oh, sorry, $1, not double hashtag. Okay. and use the replace component, substituted by the bore. Check the results. Okay. And now we will make the component which will calculate the stiffness of the half space. So to do this, I usually do it after the Sophie MSHC, MSHC. So let's type HASE and use comment half for half space type, and in type you can see that we have several options. Constant, so we only need one bore profile which will be elongated in each direction, and the whole half space will based only on this bore profile. The next one and the last one are corresponding with creating some interpolations between the bore profiles. But you have to remember that the number of the layers in each profile should be the same. Okay, you have also the control of the shape of the interpolation function between those bore profiles by applying the EP, so weight factor. Everything is described in the manual. Okay, so type in our example is constant, and it is the default value. The next one is the surface of the half space in the global system, and you should apply the same coordinate z as you did for defining the bore profile. I usually do it in this way, just to avoid some numerical mistakes. You don't have to do this, but Sophistic will inform you that it's recommended to do it. Okay, you have also the parameters of the stiffness of the half space in x, y and z direction. If you define the half space with pulse defined as a beam or truss elements, you can change, or even you should change this, the horizontal stiffness factor from 4/10 to 1. Sophistic will inform you about this, but it depends on your needs. I'm saying I sometimes reduce this stiffness, but as I said it depends on the situation. Okay, and the next one, we have to select the bore profiles. If you select coordinates or the layer half space, you have to apply more profiles. We only need to apply one, so let's copy this one to the grasshopper and we will apply it before the definition of the loads. But before that, we have to make simple substitution with z coordinates. Use the component replace and find this point. We need only the z coordination from this point, and apply the HASE program at the end. Okay, let's check it out. Okay, so HASE appeared here, and now let's find if everything is well defined. Sometimes HASE will have a problem with determining the stiffness of the half space, because of small elements, because the ending point of the piles is close to the edge between two layers, or is close to the bottom of your half space. So let's find out if everything is well defined. I will also change this minus sign to the plus in default state. So let's come back here and change it to plus. Now come back here and calculate the geometry again with the stiffness of the hull space. Those warnings are correlated with this kinematic constraints issue. Now let's check if the hull space was the stiffness of the hull space was calculated correctly, and it was really fast. You are not able to see the hull space in your animator program, but you can check it out in the WinGraph. WinGraph is a program in Sophistic which allows you to see more details in your model. So go to program and just use graphics from the Sophistic 2020. The WinGraph was renamed by the graphics. Okay, and look on the side, go to bore profiles in the system values and check the position of the bore profile. As you can see, it should be approximately on the bottom edge of the foot. It should be exactly in this place, and you can claim it by looking at this graphics. Let's go further and go to stratas, I guess. There you can check the X coordinate of the system, Y coordinate of the system, and the Z coordinates of the system of this bore profile. Next is material number, and as you can see, for first 5 meters there is material number 100, and the remaining one is 101. The stiffness modulus, the first one is stiffer than the second one. The Poisson ratio is the same. This parameter was not defined, so you are not able to see it. Cohesion should be 1 kilopascal. Friction angle should decrease. There is 30 and there should be 27. Oh, there is 7. I think we can go further. Oh, you can see that there is 27. Okay. Let's change the size of this paper. Okay, so as you can see, hull space and bore profile are defined, and the last thing you have to do to check if everything was defined correctly is to include the stiffness of the hull space into your test calculations. So the calculations where you only take into account the self wave of the model. I often do it. Okay, so go to the Sophistic, and you have to include the stiffness in the asse when you calculate the wave of your structure. I will show you it in Hasse. You have to type the function stacks, so external stiffness, with parameter opt equal to iter, and that's all. You also have to check if you have to define the stacks after or before the system definition, because I always have problem with that, and I always checking it out. Okay, so let's find check it there, but I am prepared for some errors, but there are no errors. Okay, so fantastic. It had some problem with finding the equilibrium, but those errors, those residual forces are not that much. We can increase the number of iterations that the sophistic have to do, that which sophistic has to do for each load case. You can do it in system by changing the value of the iter. The default value is 90, so go to iter and change it to 200 or even higher, 400, because the calculation is really fast. And as you can see, the stacks should be after system, so I wrote it correctly. Oh, now it it calculated more faster. It calculated faster. Okay, so let's check the results. And that, as you can see, everything seems to work correctly. Foot are going down and deck is bending as it should. You can also check the results in the wing graph, where you can for example check the displacements of the nodes. 4 millimeters maximum displacement here. Yes, sorry, minimum displacement, and maximum is 11 millimeters, and this is the and this value is corresponding with the deflection of the deck. But we can also check the deflection or the settlement of the foot, and as you can see, it's about 6 millimeters, so it's acceptable. Okay, go to the let's go to the grasshopper and implement those changes. So enter stacks opt iter, and you can change the number of iterations to 400. Okay, now everything is parameterized. So with this episode, we finish modeling our structure above the ground level and below the ground level. In next episode, we will use the model with indirect foundation, because it's more complicated and better for teaching purposes. In next episode, we will focus on defining the load cases and grouping our elements in the structure. We will start with the easiest load cases, so the stationary load cases like soil pressure, like permanent loads from the deck, so asphalt weight, barriers, and so on and so on. I would also like to encourage you to smashing the like button and subscribing to my channel. I really appreciate that. Thanks for watching, and see you later in further episodes. Bye bye.